So the book is Post-Communist Europe in Post-Communist Art in Post-Communist Europe is the title, and I would partially refer here the Piotr Piotrowski notion of horizontal art history, and then I will outline shortly my attitude towards this. So I quote, my dialectic method, wrote Marx in his afterword to the first volume of the second German edition of the Capital, is not only different from the Hegelian, but is its direct opposite. To Hegel, the life process of the human brain, that is, the process of thinking, which under the name of the idea, he even transforms into an independent subject, is the demiurgus of the real world, and the real world is only the external phenomenon from the idea. With me, on the contrary, the ideal is nothing else than the material world reflected by the human mind and translated into forms of thought. End of quote. In his discussion with Hegel, which, as I believe, constitutes the essential chapter of contemporary philosophy, Marx positioned himself as the orthodox Marxist, as defined by George Lukács. His approach to Hegelian dialectics appeared to be both contradictory and not towards Hegel's method of philosophical argument. Thus, theorizing that his dialectical method, Marx was already practicing it. The very status of Marx's gesture of defining his dialectical method as the opposite of the Hegelian one was simply subjecting dialectics to dialectical process. However, analyze from the Marxist point of view, the relationship between both types of dialectics resembles the one of the base and the superstructure. Although the base-superstructure relationship is reciprocal, the base determines the superstructure only in the last instance. Therefore, Marx's argument appears as poor and low class rather than superior to Hegel's. In my paper, I intend to confront Piotr Piotrowski's approach to geography in a similar way, both by acknowledging its dialectical structure disregarded as such by the author himself, and account it for the fidelity he never declared. In his famous article Towards Horizontal Art History, Piotrowski defines vertical narrative rooted in premises of modernist art geography. According to Piotrowski, his vertical narrative implies not only a certain hierarchy, but also the ordering of the artistic geography in terms of centers and peripheries. Although Piotrowski finds the vertical narrative problematic, he also emphasizes the crucial toughness involved in its criticism, which, despite multi-threading of his argument, can be diagnosed as the necessity of sustaining categories of the narrative. After Susanna Milewska, Piotrowski bethinks whether it is possible for such art history to arise, which could function outside of what he calls geographical dichotomies. The category is highly problematic. Piotrowski chooses to name center-periphery relationship as dichotomous, thus avoiding the concept of binary oppositions, otherwise crucial for his writings. This symptomatic omission reveals certain ambiguity in a way Piotrowski applies the concept of binary structure. Although he univocally identifies its cessation with the end of the Cold War, and I quote, since 1989, such a structure has seemed completely useless and as an instrumental for defining the world, end of quote, its roots are not manifest. And I quote, during the period of communism, as he argues in Art and Democracy, which affected not only Eastern Europe, but the entire modernist tradition of the 20th century, the world was understood in terms of a binary structure, end of quote. Modernism, continues Piotrowski, which included the communist utopia, manifests itself in a binary oppositional thinking, end of quote. The source of the concept is thus both modernism and the Cold War. acknowledged by Lenin, claiming that the new state created by the October Revolution was surrounded by and I quote, hostile capitalist encirclement, end of quote. The Cold War is commonly defined as geopolitical tension between the communist Eastern Bloc and the capitalist Western Bloc. In his book, In the Shadow of Yalta, Piotrowski respects this division using notions of East Central Europe in Polish edition and Eastern Europe in English translation, and respectively, stronger because stable and more stable notion of Western Europe, which is unchanged. Piotrowski thus subjugates to Western hegemony, equipping the notional shift that his reader, English reader, is not aware of. So the shift from East Central Europe to Eastern Europe, with a comment, and I quote, "I will follow the Western usage, except where I need to be more narrowly precise," end of quote. He subjugates, but as I will later prove, he does not surrender. In Art and Democracy, Piotrowski, using the concept of post-communist Europe, claims that terms such as Eastern Europe, the former Eastern Europe, East Central Europe, or simply Central Europe, appear in the text as synonyms, probably because thinking in categories of disintegration of the binary structure, he leaves behind all narratives it generated. As an academic teacher and a scholar writing in his native language, Piotrowski was radically attached to the notion of East Central Europe, arguing, and he was using at the time when I was his student, the notion of Central Eastern Europe, because the word central was before the word Eastern. Arguing that, but it was later translated into English as East Central Europe. Arguing that Dash separating its components reflects its eternally conflictual character. Although in the title of his recent book, Globalizing Art of Eastern Europe, that you already seen, he uses the notion of Eastern Europe. In the actual text of the book, his initial attachment, in the actual text of the book, his initial attachment is strongly observable. Although Piotrowski structured his argument both with post-structuralist and Marxist constructions, particularly attached to the Derridian notion of difference, and later the idea of radical democracy defined by Chantal Mouffe, which he perceived as a parallel structure, he never reached the Derridian positions, the book in which the French philosopher demonstrates the tension between difference and Hegelian Aufhebung, the notion which with contradictory meanings, such as to abolish and to preserve, used by Hegel in order to reflect the thesis-antithesis interaction. The text seems to be of crucial importance for understanding the nature of horizontal art history and the aforementioned subjugation, which I refuse to characterize as surrendering. As Derrida claims, I quote, "To deconstruct the opposition, first of all, is to overturn the hierarchy at a given moment. To overlook this phase of overturning is to forget the conflictual and subordinating structure of oppositions. Therefore, one might proceed too quickly to a neutralization that in practice would leave the previous field untouched," end of quote. Piotrowski defines horizontal art history similarly as the necessity of the deconstruction of vertical art history, that is, the history of Western art, which aims not at the abolishment of Western art history, naming it as such, rather than recognizing it as universal. The process of necessary naming contradictions the sustainment of categories such as East and West, or center and periphery. Contrary to Piotrowski, Derrida decisively ascribes binary structure to the West, perceiving the meaning constituted in the West as defined in terms of binary oppositions, which he calls a violent hierarchy, where, and I quote, "one of two terms governs the other," end of quote. Positions by Derrida operates with possibility of different visualization of the binary structure dictated by Cold War regime. The one that corresponds with the quotation of Lenin acknowledging the existence of the hostile capitalist encirclement. The image created that way is far from symmetrical structure suggested by jointly exhaustive and mutually exclusive dichotomies, resembling rather the image created by L. Lisicki, with the red wedge annexing the white circle. And I propose to perceive this image as a map, which is not symmetrical. The very image equips the viewer with binary asymmetrical structure, which tends to change as the minor red wedge expands visually. Its power relies on the fact it may serve as an apt illustration of the dialectical mechanism, dialectical materialism. In Piotrowski's writing, one can track down the Marxist background of the author in his claim that horizontal art history should provincialize the West. It must identify it as one of its regions, which seems to introduce the dialectical relationship of West-East-Center-Periphery. Although underestimated in East Central Europe, Marxist background constitutes crucial tool of analysis and can be found in two theoretical constructions, which I argue were decisive for the constitution of Piotrowski's theoretical approach. The first was the category of a margin elaborated by Andrzej Turowski in the second half of the 90s, the notion anchored in the Derridean concept of paragon, which was defined by Turowski as a privileged and thus critical position, capable of undermining the body of the hegemonic text. And in the same sense, Piotrowski is using the notion of periphery. The second introduced by Igor Zabel in 1997 for the first time in his essential text, We and the Other, outlines a seemingly symmetrical structure of We and the Other, only to subject it to what can be interpreted as a dialectical process involving rewriting of those notions and condemning East Central Europe to a category of the other's other, thus depriving it from its subjectivity. Similarly, the very structure of the notion of horizontal art history, rooted in the notion of critical geography as introduced by Irit Rogov, seems to be of dialectical nature. Invalidating the dichotomy of history and geography, Rogov, Rogov perceives geography as a site for various histories, national, collective, etc. Piotrowski claims the crucial problem of horizontal art history is the problem of localization. According to him, art historical narrative reveals the essential tension between highly appreciated international narrative and depreciated national one that is of a geographical kind. For Piotrowski, I disagree. At the end of his text, Piotrowski is opposing posing a question of a crucial importance, seemingly crucial, crucial importance, about material conditions which supported the national construction of the history of modern art. He answers, however, touches upon the subject of the lack of direct communication and communication among cultures. Reflecting upon dialectical geography and horizontal art history understood as such, I would like to introduce two binary oppositions that are both present and omitted in such a perspective. One of a labor and capital. It enables to perceive both the coupling of East, West, and Center, Periphery as dialectical, to avoid the homogenization of the notion of the West, to recognize it simply as a field of a class struggle. Also, the West is a field of class struggle. The so-called West inscribed in the binary Cold War oppositions would equal to both possession of means of productions, of production. It can be, for instance, to Piotrowski, it was language. He didn't use, of course, Marxist philosophy, but I analyze it from this point of view, and concentration of capital. However, freed from its own shackles, it appears as differentiated in terms of a class struggle. The notion of the West is therefore primarily oppressive towards all those geographically geographically Western narratives, which are either excluded from accumulation of both economic and symbolic capital, or what is even worse, appropriated by what we acknowledge as the West. On the other hand, the East, selling its labor power, deprived of means of production, excluded from the accumulation of capital, needs also to be thought in a term of a class struggle. The primacy of the class division invalidated the binary oppositions of East and West, center and periphery. As long as the horizontal art history is used as a tool operating rather in the domain of a superstructural culture and art discourse rather than related to the base, it is not horizontal enough. In my book, Postcommunist Art in Postcommunist Europe, I argue that the widely acknowledged model of transformation with its constitutive poles, totalitarian communism and democracy, free from totalitarian meanings, sustains the Cold War binary structure. What Boris Budin diagnoses as a false equation of democracy and capitalism constitutes a regime which is certainly not free from totalitarian identity, as capitalism is also totalitarian to me. On the other hand, the destined pole of transformation, which Piotrowski identifies with democracy, and to me it's also problematic, involves various artistic and political movements and discourses there that are leftist. So they acknowledge the existence of communism, however they define this very differently. Transformation defined with the West paradigm appears thus as ideological construct operating with false consciousness. It does not terminate the Cold War. On the contrary, it leaves behind the certain notions such as post-communism, which after Marina Grzinic, I define as unwanted excrement of a process of transformation. It produces oppressive narratives such as nostalgia, which, as aptly noticed by Edith Andrasz, upholds the Cold War structure in power. In order to disarm it, one needs to set seemingly dichotomous poles of transformation rooted in Cold War in the constant process of rewriting, emphasizing its dialectical relationship. It results with redefinition of the transformation process understood as a trigger of new form of a class struggle concealed by discourse of nationalism, ethnic exclusion, and even feminist, which I argue was very problematic in the 90s because it was a tool, it covered actual economic exclusion rather than emphasized it, that were dominating in the history of the region in 1990s. Application of the Marxism as a tool of analysis enables redefinition of both transformation and geography that has resulted from it. Dialectical approach makes possible to correct false temporality entangled in this binary division, condemning communism, which once used to be the project for the future, to the past. And this is emphasized by Derrida again in his Spectre of Mars, but I don't want to be too long. If the concept of horizontal art history constitutes a tool suitable for a vision of both art history and art geography, it needs to be practiced in reference to the base and described into both history and geography of a class struggle. Thank you very much.